I'm excited to be tuned into the Ayana Cropper Show.
To see those four young men sitting down at that lunch counter on those stools at Woodward was a source of inspiration.
Martin Luther King Jr. said that was the start of the modern day civil rights movement.
But it all started with students like the students in Greensboro who gave up, in some cases, their careers and their degrees that opened up America to where we could have presidents and governors and senators.
It's a remarkable step that we've made. Come a long way, but we've got a long way to go.
And not only talking about moving America forward, but moving the world forward.
The civil rights struggle is not a past. There's no back in the civil rights day. It is today. It will be tomorrow.
Something in my bones make me want to shout hallelujah.
But nobody's talking to God or with God or for God. And whenever we leave God out of the equation, we wind up embracing snake theology. Oh my God. Ring with the
harmony. I can recall twice, you know, wanting to give up, just saying, Lord, just take me. I just can't do it anymore. I always thought I had faith. No, I didn't. I had to go through breast cancer to know what faith was really about.
After they read the sick and shunning list, then they say, and by the way, y'all, we serving chitlins and hog maws and ham and eggs right after service. Making no connection between that sick and shut-in list and what they're feeding the people after service. I mean, shouldn't the health of Christians be better than any other group in our country?
So noble, you're going to go work in an underserved community. That's a nice passive word. Underserved, you know, underprivileged. That's another word, right? What is that? Well, that's like my third grade teacher, but that was the passive voice, right? Underprivileged. Nobody did anything to anybody. Just there's privilege and there you are under it. And we have no idea how you got down there, nor are we interested in asking.
Hearts drunk with the wine of the world.
You
You can have a ball and you not know that it's drugs or a stash in that car. And you, again, you just need to be very careful as far as who it is that you associate yourself with. And again, be careful of the choices that you make just for that quick money.
And true to our daily plan, facing the rising sun.
Hello, I'm Pastor Talbert W. Swan II of the Spring of Hope Church of God in Christ. We're a vibrant church in the heart of the city of Springfield, Massachusetts, home of the Basketball Hall of Fame. I welcome you to visit us on any Sunday morning at 11 o'clock a.m. for our morning worship celebration. You may also join us on Mondays and Wednesdays for our prayer or Tuesday night for our Bible study. You can visit our website, www.springofhopechurch.org, to get a full list of the various events that take place here at the Spring of Hope Church. I hope to see you in our sanctuary soon. At Spring of Hope, we're building better tomorrows by changing lives today. May God bless you.
And one of the issues that they are dealing with, and they dealt with just on last evening, is the school-to-prison pipeline. We have police officers that are assigned to the Springfield Public Schools. And many times our young men, instead of being dealt with by either an administrator or a teacher that has the requisite skills to deal with certain behavioral issues, or by a social worker or someone, the police are called right there in the school, and they are arrested at middle school age, arrested, put into the system, and it begins the process. And many of those young men wind up starting out at middle school age at 12 and 13 years old on the school to prison pipeline. And so we've been advocating that the school take a different approach. Take the money that you're spending and having police officers in the school and get some folks in the school that can deal with our young men. And so certainly we want to ask you, the community, to please support Ms. Gresham, support Ms. Hurst, support those members of the school committee. The NAACP is working along with the ACLU and several other organizations to try to mitigate this particular issue, because we don't need our young men starting out going to jail because they were a little noisy in a classroom.
I know that's
amen?
Right.
Amen.
Amen.
At this time, you're back in the hands of Mr. Sam Bradley. Come on, let's receive him.
Before we bring up the next act, I'd just like to clear up a little confusion. Approximately 2 weeks ago, they were having a sidebar up here for some reason. And they were asking, they were saying something about which fraternity was better. But, you know, I don't really want to get into it, but we do know the fraternity that has Martin Luther King, Frederick Douglass, W.E.B. Du Bois, Thurgood Marshall, and yours truly, FIA Fraternity Incorporated. But, ooh, fix! All right. But on a more serious note, black fraternities and sororities are good to have your children get involved in, because they build leaders. For instance, Ben Smith, Kappa, he's the owner of Dream Studio.
Yeah, right.
President of the NAACP. And myself, Alpha, I'm the CEO of Gospel Beat Entertainment. So, if you do want to get involved in a sorority or fraternity, please let us do so. All right? Because they're building leaders. Next we got coming up is Will Be Dream Studios. Now, we have to, first of all, we want to just thank Ms. Swan, Ms. Smith, and this is his birthday. So, let's give it up for him. Give it up for him. Man, we appreciate what you're doing with these girls, young ladies and young men. And they could be anywhere tonight, but they're here doing something constructive. And so let's just give them a round of applause as they come up, please.
This evening, and definitely it's always great to be among many great people and the great fraternity brothers.
Yeah.
But we all know there were several rough drafts to make this picture of perfection of Kappa Alpha Psi Fraternity Incorporated. We are the artists, we are the creative, we are the business owners, and we are here. Ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, Dream Studios performs for you. Just want to bring this dramatic piece to you, and we want to say that We wanted to do something very creative, something very artistic. And we just want to dance because we are actors, singers, and dancers. We wanted to bring a dramatic piece to you. So we want to say, ye without send, cast the first stone. Ladies and gentlemen, Destiny Weaver and Chelsea.
Thank you.
R.I.P. So now we're going to bring the Dream Ensemble dancers. Come on up, Dreamers. And this piece is Never Would've Made It.
Thank you. My history?
My history begins in Otagova, Alabama, when 999 people were pressed geographically between the marches in Selma and the bus boycotts of Montgomery.
My history?
My history began in Mobile, Alabama. I stand on the shoulders of Cudjoe Lewis and Michael Donald, whose histories are tied to the last slave ship and last lynching in America. Because of them, I stand as an educator.
What's your history?
I'm Rayford Johnson, and I'm proud to be part of California's black history. In 1945, my family moved to the little Swedish town of Kingsburg. This track is where my dreams began. Coaches and teachers at Kingsburg High encouraged me to be the best that I could be. In 1960, I won the Olympic gold medal in the decathlon. Now I come back to Kingsburg and encourage kids at Rayford Johnson Junior High.
Hello, I'm Assemblymember Nicole Parra. Join me this February in celebrating California's black history.
Kemba Smith Pradia.
Good afternoon again. In April 1995, I was sentenced in Virginia, in a Virginia U.S. District Court, to a 24.5-year prison sentence as a first-time nonviolent drug offender.
Female convict, domestic violence survivor, a former inmate turned criminal justice advocate, is trying to keep others from suffering her fate. She is one of several women News Channel 15's Tara Brantley will talk with as she begins a special series of reports. Tonight, hear from Kemba Smith, a woman who was battered but not broken.
I was only on this earth 23 years, and I was sentenced to 24 and a half years in federal prison.
The only child of a middle-class family, Kemba Smith graduated from high school and went on to pursue a degree in social work.
I simply fell in love with the wrong guy while I was a student in college.
That wrong guy was the leader of a $4 million crack cocaine ring, and in the early 1990s, one of the FBI's most wanted. Kemba handled his money.
I had talked to some bounty hunters, and he was asking me what it was that I had said during the conversation, and I could not recollect everything that I had said, and that angered him, and so he began beating me in my body and kicking me. There was a particular time where I did try to leave, but I think ultimately, because of the dynamics of the conspiracy, the drug conspiracy, he had been to my parents' home. He had killed his best friend because he thought his best friend had cooperated with the authorities. It became a point where the authorities wanted me to give them him on a silver platter. And ultimately, I just felt like a robot, like I had to do whatever it was that he told me to do in order to protect myself and in order to protect my family.
Kemba's boyfriend was found murdered, a suspect never arrested. At 7 months pregnant, she turned herself in and pleaded guilty to conspiracy, money laundering, and lying to authorities. Her sentence, 24 and a half years with no chance of parole.
To be here at Spring of Hope and Reverend Swan, I just want to thank you for your support. I don't take it lightly when pastors invite me to their church, amongst their community. I appreciate you recognizing the important issues that impact people of color the most. So again, thank you. In my parents' absence, I want to thank them. You'll hear more about them in my presentation. But they are my true heroes. They are the heroes throughout this whole Kemba Smith story. But last but not least, of course, I will not be remiss in thanking God. You almost set me up, Reverend Swan, because, you know, seeing young people, I'm very passionate about our young people, and to see them so passionate in their craft, to see what the devil meant for evil, God turned around and made it for good and to save lives. And I'm grateful that God released me from federal prison because it was meant for me to still be in federal prison today until the year 2016. So when I see the young people dance to some of my favorite spiritual songs, Never Would Have Made It Without You, yeah. I Would Have Lost It All. When I share my story, you all will understand what God has brought me through. I know you already know God's power and what he can do and understand his grace, but I will be a prime example, and hopefully when you walk out of these doors tonight, you'll be re-energized and know his power even more. Because my release date was 2016, but it actually took the President of the United States, President Bill Clinton, to sign a document that released me from federal prison after having served 6.5 years. And that was a miracle, because that's something that does not typically happen every day. So I'm very grateful, again, to have this opportunity. I also want to thank my husband, who's at home, taking care of our almost 3-year-old. God bless him. Hopefully God is watching over him. I'm noticing this little girl right here, she's so calm and patient. That would not be my daughter. She'll be running circles around here. But this is my first time in Springfield, Massachusetts, and I'm just so grateful to be here. And I'm so glad that it was warm today. I came prepared with my gloves and my hat, but I didn't even really need it. And it's just, again, amazing at how God works, because walking through the door, there was a woman who greeted me, and her daughter actually was incarcerated with me in Danbury, Connecticut. And while I was incarcerated, God seemed to put people along my path to help keep me up. So I want to thank you, Brenda's mom, if you're still in the room, for taking the time out to come hear me tonight and to be supportive. But usually I show a video where it's a BET interview clip. And in this video, you will be introduced to my parents. You will be introduced to my son. I also have an 18-year-old son who's a freshman in college. And I'll tell you more about him too, because he's got his own testimony. But in the video, you would see me in my prison uniform, in my khakis, and actually in federal prison, because some people just see me for face value and not really being able to imagine me actually being incarcerated. Don't let the clothes fool you. God has brought me through some stuff. I was a diamond in the rough. And I'm not one of those people that have been through my prison experience and said that I didn't do anything wrong or try to sugarcoat stuff. So I am grateful that there's some youth in the room so that you can gain some knowledge, because since my release in December 2000, it was important for me, despite my attorneys telling me that I needed to move on with my life and not speak out publicly about my ordeal, because they knew that the federal government was not happy about the president signing a document to release me. But despite them advising me not to speak out, I knew that God opened those doors for a reason. And I tell people, be careful what you pray for, because when I was on my knees praying to God, asking him to free me from my situation and to allow me to be a voice for our young people, so they won't have to go through the same path, affecting my family as well. But also, trying to figure out how much I'm going to get from him. That was not what was first and foremost up front in my mind. But I will share a story with you of how the first time Peter took me shopping, I remember us going into a department store, and I went over to, y'all that's already been through college and understand this, I went over to the junior sale rack, because, you know, it's hard times in school. You're not, you know, going to buy a whole bunch of stuff while you're in college. So ultimately, he goes over to the more designer wear and starts picking out things that he wants me to try on, and I try on those items, and he tells me how good I look in them. And my son tells me I need to stop using this analogy, but for those of you all who know the movie Pretty Woman, for a second, I was feeling like I was Julia Roberts.
in the movie Pretty Woman, my son says, Mom, eventually some young people, they just not even gonna know what you're talking about. But basically, when we went to the cash register, I can remember the saleswoman bringing up item after item. And I thought to myself, dang, my parents have never shopped for me like this before. I mean, yeah, we might have gone to the outlets and gotten a few things just before school. But eventually I say to him, you don't have to do this. And he said to me, but baby, I want to. Yeah, exactly. How do you think I interpreted that? Ooh, he must really love me. One of the things that my father tried to instill in me that I didn't quite get is that nothing in life is free. And so therefore, along with the abuse, eventually it came a point where Peter started telling me things that he wanted me to do. So because I was afraid of the confrontation, and truth be told, maybe because of these other items that were purchased, sometimes you may feel a sense of obligation because someone has done something for you. But I remember him telling me to do certain things. And ultimately, because I was scared of confrontation from the first time he put his hands on me, whatever it was he told me to do, I would do it. And I strongly urge you all to make sure that you don't get caught up in that drug dealer lifestyle and what you see in the movies, what you see in music videos, and so, ain't nothing pretty about it. In closing, because I do want to give the opportunity that if anyone wants to ask any questions, please understand that our community is in need. It's in a state of emergency, in my opinion. And I travel across the country and I talk to youth, and that's why it's so, you know, moving for me to see young people actually doing positive things and in the church. But I see so many of our youth coming up to me afterwards one-on-one because I share with them my ordeal. They feel a connection with me and they want to share with me what they're going through. Stuff that'll make you want to fall down on your knees and just boo-hoo cry for hours. So please understand that we have some work to do and that we need to make sure that we're connecting with our youth, that we're speaking up for those policies that affect us the most, and who cares what other people think. We need to be doing what we need to be doing for ourselves as a people. I know for my parents, I thank God that they didn't care about what people thought. Because sometimes, if you have a family member that's incarcerated, you don't want other people to know because you think it's an embarrassment or a shame. But I can remember being in the television room in prison, seeing my dad on CNN talking about these same issues. So please keep up the fight. Understand that we still have a lot of work to do. I'm going to end with this quote from Martin Luther King, where he says, on some positions, cowardice asks the question, is it safe? Expediency asks the question, is it politic? And vanity comes along and asks the question, is it popular? But conscience asks the question, is it right? And there comes a time when one must take a position that is neither safe, nor politic, nor popular, but he must do it because conscience tells him it is right. Thank you so much. Did, but I do not demonize him because he was not a total monster. He did have a charismatic personality that people gravitated towards, but But I don't want my son to ever feel less of a man because of who his father was or because his mother was. Information again on choices and consequences. Peter was raised, he was from Jamaica, but he was raised in Teaneck, New Jersey. His father had his own business, a cleaning business, but he had a brother that went to Columbia University, a sister that went to Vassar College who was an attorney, but he also had two other brothers that hustled. So it's all about the path that you take and the journey that you go on. Yes, ma'am. You were
saying? She got a mic.
Oh, okay. Oh, all right. Sorry.
Oh, I was just going to ask you. You said something. You was going to mention something about your son.
Thank you. My son, he is a testimony in his own. It was important for me to, after coming out of prison, because I know our community some of the time feels as if counseling is taboo. But it was important as a broken woman, having been in an abusive relationship and been away from my son, for me to seek out counseling. So I did go to counseling. A woman who I was friends with too that helped walk me through the process. But ultimately, my son is 18 years old, a freshman at Washington and Lee University. He has kept education his priority and has stayed.
Outstanding community service and commitment to social justice. February 26, 2013. Thank you for your work and your dedication to this. Stand next to your booth.
first of all, thank you so much for coming to Springfield, Massachusetts, and sharing your story. It's wonderful. So my show is Sitting on Top of Show and Excellence, and what I'm going to do is just kind of ask a few questions.
Okay.
And so first of all, can you just talk a little bit about what you share with the audience here at the church? Well, first and foremost, I have to thank Reverend Swan for having me here at Spring of Hope and in Springfield, Massachusetts, my first time here. So much love and support in this area. But it was just really important for me to share my testimony with the poor choices that I made that led to my 24 and a half year prison sentence. And to share the choices with the young people so hopefully they won't go down the same path, and to speak about the advocacy work that I've been involved in since my release, but more importantly, the power of God and what He can do and how He brought me out of that situation, and the blessings and grace that He's bestowed upon me with having a second chance at life. Oh, that's amazing. You have a really great testimony. And so talk a little bit about your foundation and what your foundation is doing right now in terms of this whole advocacy around the drug sentencing. Yes, my foundation is has always been geared towards preventative education, and pretty much my parents initiated while I was still incarcerated, where I'm a founder of the organization because I created the mission statement and objectives. But ultimately, since my release, I've been speaking to youth and different sponsored events that deal with particular issues. But I've co-partnered with another organization called National Alliance of Faith and Justice. And it's an initiative that's geared towards girls called What's Love Got to Do With It? And you can go on my foundation website. But basically, it's thematic issues that are discussed with young girls revolved around my story. Okay. And so you can get more information about them. Wonderful. Now, what would you tell a young African-American woman that's maybe struggling with some of the things that you struggled with? What would you say to them right now?
Just the importance of loving yourself and understanding you're a woman of God, and focusing on your goal, your dream of what you want to become, and try not to let any outside distractions or toxic relationships deter you from that path, and always keeping God first and in guidance and making that dream a reality, but just making sure that you have positive people around you. And some of the times, people need to be careful who it is that they associate with, who they have in their circle. So I would just, start off with just loving yourself first, because I think when you do that and really know how to do it, you make better choices in associations and in everything that you do and moving forward in life.
Wonderful. Well, thank you so much for joining me today. I really appreciate it. And your testimony, your story is so inspiring, so uplifting. I know that someone in this audience today was able to listen and hear and really move out on what you said today.
Thank you. And I appreciate all of what you do and your support and encouragement. But had it not been for major media and local media, there are several people that may not have even known about my story and may have not even gotten involved. Had it not been for the media, I could still be incarcerated today. But fortunately, people chose to highlight my story and get it out there. And between that and my parents, that allowed those prison doors to open. So thank you for all that you do.
Absolutely. Thank you. And thank your parents. And I know your son and your daughter are probably loving you up.
Yeah,
and of course, your new marriage. Congratulations on that.
Thank you.
It's a blessing. And you're truly a blessing. You're anointed. I just want to say that to you. And God has a plan for you. He's got something very special. And so we thank you so much. And so thank you for joining the Ayanna Crawford Show on Excellence. I'm here with Kemba Smith Pradia, the wonderful, illustrious speaker, dynamic woman who has just graced us with her presence and her testimony about being incarcerated and how women and girls need to be in the next generation. So again, thank you so much for joining us, and we look forward to tuning in next time to the Ayanna Crawford Show on Excellence. Thank you.
Anna! Hey, we got your lunch.
You don't have to be perfect to be a perfect parent. Because kids in foster care don't need perfection. They need you. The smallest moments can have the biggest impact on a child's life. Take time to be a dad today.
Here we go.
You don't have to be perfect to be a perfect parent. Because kids in foster care don't need perfection. They need you.
We will now hear from Ms. Kemba Smith Pradia.
Good afternoon again. In April 1995, I was sentenced in Virginia, in a Virginia U.S. District Court, to a 24.5-year prison sentence as a first-time nonviolent drug offender. I was the girlfriend of a drug dealer who was physically abusive. Due to our nation's harsh and disproportionate conspiracy and crack cocaine drug laws, even though the prosecutor stated that I never handled, used, or sold any of the drugs involved in my case, I was sentenced to the total amount of drugs within the conspiracy. Thank goodness for organizations such as the NAACP and that they were created for these purposes to deal with certain injustices. Because the NAACP Legal Defense Fund represented me pro bono and the NAACP advocated on my behalf as well. And actually, it was years ago as a Rhodes Scholar that Ben Jealous was one of the first people to mention my case to President Clinton. After serving 6.5 years in federal prison, President Bill Clinton commuted my 24.5-year prison sentence. Had it not been for this act of the United States President commuting my sentence, I would still be serving my prison sentence today until the year 2016. Despite receiving executive clemency, one of the collateral consequences of having been incarcerated is losing my right to vote. In 2008, during the most historical presidential election in the United States, I was not able to cast my vote due to state disenfranchisement laws. In Virginia, a convicted person would need to pay an outstanding fines and court costs
complete their supervised release, which I had 60 months of. Then after completing supervised release, there is a mandatory 3 or 5 year waiting period before a convicted person can apply for restoration of voting rights based upon if whether you have a nonviolent or violent offense. If you have a nonviolent drug charge, you automatically fall within the 5 year period simply because you have a drug case. I wasn't eligible to apply to have my rights restored until 2010. In 2009, I got married and moved to Indianapolis, Indiana, and I was unsure as to my voting status. But someone suggested that I go to the Bureau of Motor Vehicles and fill out a voter registration form and just see what happens. Within a few weeks, I received my voter registration card, and in November 2010, I was able to vote for the first time in Indiana. Unfortunately, I will have to readdress this issue again for the 2012 elections because I will be relocating back to Virginia in June. Therefore, I have to go through the tedious and bureaucratic process of applying for restoration of my voting rights. I struggle with the fact that as of today, that I cannot vote in Virginia because this is where my offense occurred, but in other states, I wouldn't even have to deal with this issue. It is as if other states understand the need for one to be forgiven and move on with their life and not wanting them to feel isolated from the rest of the general population because they've been denied this basic human right. When my son was younger, I remember him asking me who I was going to vote for in the upcoming elections. And I found it hard to explain that Virginia has categorized me as not being human enough to vote because I have a past felony conviction. I remember going out with the Get Out the Vote effort, and I was with my son. This was on the day of the election, and I was videotaping the differences between if you go to one poll site that, and it was in the suburbs of the city, how it was a fast process and there weren't long lines. But then when I took him on the other more impoverished side, urban communities, he saw how there were very long lines. And at that particular point, I had thought that I would, you know, be out on the streets, you know, excited, just, you know, recording people and just being a part of the process in that manner. But after I dropped my son off at school, I went home and I was depressed and sad as if I still did something wrong because I wasn't afforded the same opportunity as everyone else on that day. And it disturbs me at the fact that the only citizens that are not afforded the right to vote are mentally disabled people and minors. Virginia and other states want to continue to put people with felony offenses in this category, even though we are and can be productive tax-paying members of society. I speak for many. Nationally, more than 5 million citizens are disenfranchised from being a part of the political process simply because of their past felony conviction, and more than 2 million are African Americans. And I represent many. I'm not just speaking on behalf of my own personal situation. I've been blessed where I did receive executive clemency from the United States as it relates to drug sentencing and policy, and it would have been very easy for me to just shut that door and move on with my life and not even deal with these issues. But like Martin Luther King said, A threat to justice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. So for me coming out, it's been important for me to still continue speaking out for the voiceless and speaking out for the millions who wish that they had the opportunity in 2012 to be a part of this political process, which is a basic human right. Thank you.